الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله وآله وصحبه من والاه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. إن شاء الله. The masjid on Friday is very beautiful. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to also gather us in the Akhirah مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. آمين يا رب العالمين. It's like a lot of people. Before I start my halaqah tonight, inshallah ta'ala, as usual, I would request the parents to bring their kids, inshallah ta'ala, a little bit to the front, to be in the front line, inshallah ta'ala. Because they're going to be in the front line, inshallah, very soon. We just heard some people running in the prayer, maybe because they wanted to join the prayer in ruku' or something, and I wanted to comment on this because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one time was praying, فَسَمِعَ جَلَبَةً, was praying alayhi salatu wasalam, and he heard a loud voice. People were actually hastening to the prayer to be able to join with him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his ruku', maybe so they don't miss the rak'ah. And after his prayer, he turned his face towards his people and he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إذا أتيتم الصلاة فعليكم بالسكينة فما أدركتم فصلوا وما فاتكم فأتموا. When you come to the prayer, you need to walk peacefully with tranquility, and whatever you can pray with the imam, pray it with the imam, and if you miss any part, make it up yourself after the imam is done with the prayer. من صحيح البخاري جاء رجل إلى المسجد فركع دون الصف. That is a very interesting narration. A man came to why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he came to the masjid and Nabi ﷺ was in his ruku'. And the man knows that if he joins the prayer while النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم or the imam is in ruku', he doesn't have to make up that rak'ah. So what he did, radiallahu anhu, one of the Sahaba, once he came into the masjid from the door, he made ruku' at the door over there. Do you know what I'm saying? Raka'a dun as-saf. Huh? He made ruku' at the door and he walked while he's making ruku' and joined the line. Just because he doesn't want to make up the raka'. Look what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him. He told him three letters that the scholars read them in three different ways. يبقى ثلاث حروف نراهم بثلاث طرق يطلعوا ثلاث أحكام. He only told him three letters sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The scholars of hadith, they read those three letters in three ways with three different tashkils, and they led to three different fiqh rulings. Ready for it? قال صلى الله عليه وسلم زادك الله حرصا. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for intention that you came to join the prayer, you wanted to join the prayer in ruku'ah, and that's why you made ruku'ah at the door. I understand. But وَلَا تَعُدْ تَا فَتْحَ عَيْنِ ضَمَّ وَلَا تَعُدْ, meaning do not do this again. That's wrong. You need to walk peacefully with tranquility even if you're going to miss the rak'ah. But do not ever make ruku' at the door and walk while you make ruku'. That doesn't make sense. يبقى ولا تعد. ولا تعد. The second way the scholars read it, ولا تعد. تاء فتحة عين كسرة. That's another fiqh ruling. So the first fiqh ruling, you're not allowed to do this again, that's wrong. You only make ruku' when you join the saf, the line. The second ruling, وَلَا تُعِدْ, meaning What you've done, it's already done. You don't have to repeat this rak'ah. You already joined the rak'ah because you were making ruku' while we're making ruku'. He's very merciful, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He just let it go. That's wrong, but don't do it again, and you don't have to repeat the rak'ah. Khalas. The third way the scholars read those three letters, or these three letters, wala ta'd. Ta'fatha ayn sukoon. وَلَا تَعْد means العدو is to run. Running is العدو. Meaning when you come to the prayer, don't run again. That's wrong. So three fiqh rulings from these three letters that the scholars رضوانullahi alayhim read them in three different ways. So interesting narration. Sahih Bukhari. You don't do it again. That's wrong. You don't have to repeat the rak'ah if you join in ruku'ah. Number three, when you come to prayer, come peacefully and do not run. We just heard some kids coming from downstairs. By the way, we also hear some elders. Sometimes they come to the masjid and they really run to be able to join the rak'ah while the imam is in ruku'ah. And that is wrong. Please, for Allah's sake, stop that. It's normal to miss the rak'ah. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam gave that option. He said, وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّ meaning he's expecting that some of us are going to miss some rak'ahat and we have to make them up. So please come to the prayer with tranquility. So I would actually highly recommend that for the karate lessons going downstairs, maybe to finish not at 8 sharp, maybe you finish at 10 to 8 to give the kids and their teacher time to go make wudu and get ready for the prayer, inshallah ta'ala, from now on, yani. طيب, let's go now to our halaqah tonight, where we're going to talk about. Before I start, who attended the second khutbah today? Could you please raise your hand? Okay, very few people. I have like 4 people only attended the second khutbah. The reason I'm asking is that in the first khutbah we had guest speaker Sheikh Yusuf Badat, hafizahullah ta'ala, and he talked about a different topic. But the topic that I talked about in the second khutbah, I think it's really important. And I'm not going to repeat it again. I'm just going to ask some questions. And the people who raise their hands, they have to answer these questions. Because we discussed the number 90 today. So we're going to review 90 and go to 91, 92, inshallah ta'ala, very briefly. Because this topic is really important, because last Friday we were talking about number 87 in Surah Al-Ma'idah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُحَرِّمُوا طَيِّبَاتِ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. O believers, do not forbid the good things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made lawful for you. So some people might go so extreme thinking that there is no restrictions, there is no any limitations, whatever desires I have, I can fulfill them. Then immediately in the next call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, next call I mean, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. He's addressing the believers, all you who have believed. The next call, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned 4 desires that people used to do in the past, and some of them are still being done today, and he's saying those are haram. Meaning, I just opened the door for you to fulfill your halal desires, but still there are some haram desires you're not allowed to fulfill. What are these 4 things? قال الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان فاجتنبوه لعلكم تفلحون. So now we're going to ask questions. Who remembers or who knows what does the word khamr mean? The word khamr. You were in the khutbah today?
Yes,
you did use your hand. Okay, no problem. I'll accept from you, inshallah. Al-khamr, ikhwa, in Arabic language, it means al-mukhamara is to cover something. So anything that covers our minds, that it cannot function properly, or we cannot think properly, any kind of intoxication, let it be alcohol, marijuana, you name it, whatever else, is haram in Islam. That is called the khamr. And that's why the head cover of the Muslim woman is called what in Arabic language? Khimar. It has another name, hijab. But one of its names is khimar, because it covers the hair. So anything that covers the minds of people so they cannot think properly and act properly, that is called the khamr. And the Nabi said, كُلُّ مُسْكِرٍ خَمْرٍ. Anything that will make the person intoxicated is considered the khamr in Islam. وَكُلُّ خَمْرٍ حَرَامٍ. I'm not going to go to fiqh al-hanafiyya tonight. I'm just talking from hadithi perspective. Anything that intoxicates the mind of a human being is called khamr, and it is haram in Islam. That's number one. Number two, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ. Quickly, inshallah. Al-maysir means what? Al-maysir. Gambling. Al-maysir, it comes from the word yusr. Yusr in Arabic language is ease. So what happens basically in gambling, that the person can gain a lot of money without making any effort. And that's why it's called the maysir, from the ease. You take the money very easily without making any effort. Or some people can lose some money without also making any effort. And that's why al-maysir is called maysir from the word yusr, which is ease. And anything in Islam happens in that way, that you gain money without any effort in competitions, that is haram. Lottery is haram. Rolling dice on money is haram. Putting money in a horse, in a race, so if it wins, they take a lot of money on that ticket, that is haram. Playing chess on money is haram. Playing chess without money is a controversial issue among the scholars. We have two different opinions. Some of them say it's haram, some of them say it's halal. But on money, it's unanimously haram. طيب, يبدأ الميسر. الميسر is al-qimar, it's gambling. Haram in Islam. طيب. Number three, al-ansab. If anybody remembers, al-ansab are the idols that people used to worship before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with Islam. Very briefly. And nowadays, al-ansab literally is idols. But idols nowadays is not only idols that people worship. It can also be a person that people really love and admire and imitate. Like some of our youth today, they really love some certain singers or some certain players or artists or artists or you know, writers, and they try to even act like them because they see them as a role model. When you see our youth walking today, or even the way they talk to you, the way they talk, the way they walk, they try to act like certain singers. I personally don't like to see that even. I do not see that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, your idol should be only Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or his sahaba radwanullahi alayhim. طيب, that's it, al-ansab. Al-ansab is related to shirk. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about shirk here after talking about al-khamr and al-maysir? To tell us that al-khamr and al-maysir, intoxicants and gambling, is as worse or as bad as worshipping idols. It's very close to shirk. Very big sin in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number four is al-azlam. That's the most interesting. Does anybody remember al-azlam quickly? Al-azlam?
Sort of a lottery stuff. You know, you pick up something.
Exactly. It's like drawing lots. You know what they used to do? I will just use analogy to make it so easy for us. Nowadays, in Islam, if I want to do something, if I want to take a step forward in my life, I want to get married, for example. I'm married, alhamdulillah, by me. Somebody wants to get married. Or someone else who wants to go to a certain degree, study in a certain degree, educational degree. Or somebody wants to move from his job, to another place. What do we do in Islam before we do any of these decisions? What do we do? So the first thing that comes to our minds is istikhara. And we forget about the practical dimension. We forget about planning. We forget about putting a strategy. We forget about asking people of experience. And we jump immediately to istikhara. And that's why most of us come to the sheikhs and go ask, hey, sheikh, I have prayed istikhara 10 times. By the way, you don't have to pray istikhara 10 times. One time is enough. But put a strategy first and have a plan. Ask people of experience and study the situation to the most of your ability, and then pray istikhara. The practical dimension and the spiritual dimension. In Islam, we have this balance between spirituality and materialism. So in Islam, if we take a decision, before we take a big decision in our life, يعني we pray استخارة سيدنا قال صحيح البخاري يعني كان رسول الله يعلمنا الاستخارة في الأمور كلها يعني طيب كما يعلمنا السورة من القرآن. We need to memorize that دعاء في استخارة as just like الفاتحة exactly. The way you recite الفاتحة, you need to memorize دعاء الاستخارة the way you memorize الفاتحة. That's how رسول الله used to teach the صحابة دعاء الاستخارة سيدنا جابر سيد صحيح البخاري. But in the past, the disbelievers, what they used to do is this. They bring some arrows or lots or some small pieces of wood, let's say three pieces, and they write in the first piece, do it, افعل. On the second piece, they write, don't do it, لا تفعل. On the third piece of wood, they keep it blank. They don't write anything. And then they put those three pieces of wood in a container and shake them and then close their eyes and pick one. If the one that says, if'al, do it, is picked, just go and do it. He go and gets married. He go and moves. He goes and moves, right? But if the one that says, do not do it, is picked, he wouldn't do that thing. If the third one, which is blank, is picked, he will repeat again. Shake it again, close his eyes, and pick another one. That's how they used to take the decisions, and that is called al-azlam, and that is haram in Islam. In Islam, we're not supposed to take our decisions like that. In Islam, we put a strategy, we have our plan, plan A, plan B, and then we ask people of experience, and then we pray istikhara and take our decisions. That's called al-azlam. So al-khamr, wal-maysir, wal-ansab, wal-azlam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those four things are rijis. Rijis in Islam means impurity. Impurity, something dirty. And that's why the scholars consider khamr not only haram, it's also like urine in Islam. It's like urine. It's something najis. Al-khamr, alcohol in Islam is najis. You cannot pray in an area that has khamr on it. Like a carpet that has khamr on it, you cannot pray in that place. You cannot, somebody cannot pray with a bottle of alcohol or wine in his bottle. He cannot do that. I heard yesterday somebody came to the masjid with two bottles of wine and he was spilling them at the masjid. Is it proven? Somebody heard something like that? I just heard that somebody came to the masjid and he had two bottles of wine and he was spilling them in the masjid. I don't understand where this is coming from. So maybe we need to verify the narrator and what is the narration, you know. Anyways, I don't know. I don't know the narration. If you've heard anything, please come and tell us. طيب ان شاء الله بعد الحلقه هديك وقت تسال
just a quick question here most of the
can we have questions at the end
okay
جزاك الله خير طيب back to our lesson رجس من عمل الشيطان he said they are dirty and also they are from عمل الشيطان عمل الشيطان doesn't mean that شيطان does them that شيطان loves them so much that he keeps whispering to human beings to do those four things because he wants to achieve something what does he want to achieve if we do those four things in the next ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says by the way before the next ayah Allah says فَجِتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ he did not only say stop doing those things Do not practice those things. He did not say that. He said, فَجِتَنِبُوهُ Janb in Arabic language is aside. Meaning, you should be in a side, and those four things should be in the other side. You are as far as possible from them. فَجِتَنِبُوهُ That's the word, فَجِتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ If you want to achieve success in this world and in the hereafter, inshallah ta'ala. طيب. Next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned four consequences. If we don't fix these four things in our community, they're going to lead to four negative consequences. Two of them are related to dunya. Dunya related. They affect our community. And the other two are akhira related. What are these four things? قال الله عز وجل إنما يريد الشيطان أن يوقع بينكم العداوة والبغضاء What the shaitan wants to achieve in your communities is to create animosity and hatred amongst you. Please, let me say it again. إنما يريد الشيطان أن يوقع بينكم العداوة والبغضاء. Shaitan's ultimate goal is to see people fighting. Please, regardless of the justification, they have done this, they have been doing that, regardless of whatever justification you might have, fights that we have with other community members inside of the Muslim community, fights that we have inside of our families, Shaitan is so happy, that's his ultimate goal. Allah said, yurid, that's his will. أَيُّقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ is to cause between you animosity and hatred. These are two things related to this dunya that can destroy in a community. في الخمر والميسر. And they are caused if you don't stop الخمر and الميسر. وَيَصُدَّكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَعَنِ الصَّلَاةِ. The other two consequences, the shaitan wants us to be related to خمر, ميسر, أنصاب, أزلام, to stay away from two main things that are related to the akhirah, ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Because somebody, when somebody is so much into gambling, when somebody is drunk, he cannot concentrate that he has to go pray. So he doesn't pray on time. وَيَصُدَّكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. At that time, while he is committing that sin, he doesn't remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what the shaitan exactly wants to do. He wants to create animosity and hatred in this world, and in the akhirah, he wants to make you stay away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the prayer. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ. That's actually a rhetorical question. He's not asking, are you guys going to stop? No, he's not asking the question like that. He's actually asking a rhetorical question. Are you going to stop or what? Are you Muslims going to stop doing this or what? Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, you know the khamr, it was prohibited on stages. Before the last stage, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, they used to drink alcohol in groups. And Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu in Sahih al-Bukhari, he was serving al-khamr in the house of Sayyidina Abu Talha radiallahu anhu before the khamr was completely prohibited. He said, I was serving al-khamr, he was pouring al-khamr to people to drink in the gathering, in the house of Abu Talha, until Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent someone to tell people, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ الْخَمْرَ قَدْ حُرِّمَتْ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sending me to you to warn you and to tell you that the khamr is now completely prohibited. Before that, it was only prohibited at the prayer times. But now it's completely prohibited. فَهَلْ هَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ. Are you going to stop doing this or what? يقول سيدنا أنس رضي الله عنه فأمرني أبو طلحة بأن أسكبها أو كما قال فسال الخمر في المدينة. He said, we poured all the khamr that we have on the streets of Medina, and the streets of Medina were full of alcohol. So by the Sahaba رضوان الله عليهم, obeying the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إنما يريد الشيطان أن يوقع بينكم العداوة والبغضاء في الخمر والميسر ويصدكم عن ذكر الله وعن الصلاة فأنتم منتهون. Last آية وأطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول واحذروا. Obey Allah and obey His Messenger and beware إن توليتم. If you turn your backs towards Allah سبحانه وتعالى فاعلموا أنما على رسولنا البلاغ المبين. أنما. Indeed, the only mission of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is to tell you what's right and what's wrong, and the rest is up to you. You cannot force anyone. And that's what I have to say at the end of this halaqah. We speak about khamr and we say how bad it is to our youth and to ourselves before them. And we say that the scholars, like Imam Zamakhshari in Kashafihi, for example, he said it's close to the shirk. And that's why Allah put it in the same ayah with al-ansab and al-azlam, right? It's so bad to even come close to al-khamr. There are some cursed people who sell it and people who buy it, people who squeeze it, people who manufacture it, people who carry it, people who sell it and buy it. Like in anything that's close to khamr, you stay away from it. But at the same time, we believe that we live in a country that believes in the freedom of expression and all kinds of freedom that you just name it. Any kind of freedom. So if you see a non-Muslim drinking alcohol, there's something you need to keep in mind. غَيْرُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ خَيْرُ مُخَاطَبِينَ بِفُرُوعِ الشَّرِيعَةِ. The non-Muslim is not addressed by this sharia. Meaning, you cannot judge a non-Muslim by Islam. I can't. Because he doesn't even believe in this religion. Why would I go judge him? So what I want to say is this. We believe that everyone had the right to do whatever he wants, if he wants to do drink alcohol. But at the same time, we also have the right to speak about our religion and implement our religion on ourselves and our families inside of our masajid and our homes. That's fair enough. Everybody do whatever you want, and please, let us say what we believe in and implement our Islam the way we see fit. That is the last thing I want to end this halaqah with, inshallah ta'ala. And we still have questions. We'll just start with this one, inshallah. Okay, maybe after the halaqah, inshallah, we'll discuss it. What's your question, Ahi?
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. We learned, alhamdulillah, a lot. Khamar, as you said, you can't have a bottle of khamar and do the namaz. Yes. Today we have a lot of these perfumes that we spray coming to the masjid also. All of them, they are like 99% alcohol. Should we stop?
Okay, what our scholars actually told us is alcohol is of different kinds. We have too many different kinds of alcohol. The one that's prohibited to drink is not the same one that they use in perfumes. It's different. It's not the same alcohol that you're not allowed to drink. So you're allowed to use it. That's what our scholars told us. But if you have another fatwa, I absolutely respect that. But we asked our sheikhs this question and they told us alcohol is of different kinds. Alcohol is of different kinds. The kind that's not allowed to drink is not the same kind that they use in perfumes, and it evaporates after some time, and that's why you're allowed to use perfumes that has alcohol in it. That's the fatwa that we took from our sheikhs. Yeah.
Just to add on to that, did they also consider or account for alcohol in mouthwash? Is it also a different kind as well?
I'm not sure about that one, but when I came here first, I had this mouthwash, and it doesn't have zero written on it, and I didn't know it actually. My wife told me it can have alcohol in it, so I just stopped using it for no other reason than I would swallow it unintentionally. I would swallow it unintentionally when I gargle, and that's why I stopped using it, but I'm not sure about this kind. So when we come to doubtful matters like this, the best way to do it is to avoid it if you have another alternative. But if you don't have another alternative, you can use the fatwa that I just told you. As for the mouthwash, I'm not sure about that. We can still ask and come back to you, but I'm not sure about that one. Yep. Okay. Okay. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayka. Inni da'in fa'aminu. اللهم لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين صل عليه في الآخرين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين اللهم علمنا من ديننا ما جهلنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا يا ربنا علما اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا وأصلح ذات بيننا وانزع الغل والحقد من صدورنا اللهم طهر صدورنا وصف نفوسنا واجعلنا سلما لإخواننا هداة لغيرنا آمين 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 وصل اللهم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته